the Koz and Bru Show. Highly energetic open from myself and from you, Koz. I mean, and that's surprising because you went to a show last night. I want to hear about this show that we're going to talk about other stuff, obviously. But the show, you called me from the show. You were giddy, like you just stumbled upon something amazing. And all I did was stay up and watch Beer Fest, and I'll tell you all about that. But no, we're going to cover NBA stuff on the show. We're going to cover the Clippers. We're going to cover Steve Ballmer. We're going to cover Steve Kerr. two Steves. Totally different points of view. cover some OKC, some Sam Presti. And you know what? We said this is going to be a quick pod. We're going to cover tampering in the NBA.
Yeah, no problem.
I mean, just some small topics that we can just race through. But let's start with the show. Cause what was this? I mean, I've been waiting. Tell me.
So last night I got to see the Nappy Roots. I don't know if you're familiar with the Nappy Roots. They're a Kentucky hip hop group. I think their first album dropped in like the early 2000s, like 2001 or two, something like that. So I hadn't heard from them in a while. So they're in Sebastopol. And so for those of you who don't know, Sebastopol is a pretty hippie town, you know?
Yes, you so, think.
So it was like, the Sebastopolness of the show was so awesome. Like the people watching, so they had a DJ on before because the show, they said it was going to be at 9. I don't think they got on until about 12. Well,
by the way, a high concentration of my high school friends' parents have moved to Sebastopol for the sole purpose of growing pot. I'm not kidding.
It's like the Florida of Sonoma County. You know,
like, these are talking like straight edge parents from my high school days.
Totally. Yes.
You moved to Sebastopol to grow pot. That's awesome.
Yeah. It's crazy, right? That's so funny. But anyway, like, so there were a couple of the people watching before the Nappy Roots were awesome, by the way. If you have a chance to see them live, please do. They were awesome. They definitely embraced their Kentuckiness, and they like brought bourbon on the stage, and if you had a glass, they were actually pouring shots like during the show. So it was pretty cool. There was one guy who was a bit on the flamboyant side, and he danced probably the entire, so the 3 hours the DJ was on and the entire show, and he never once was on beat. And then like there was also, he also had props, like he was dancing and then like all of a sudden you look over, he had a hula hoop, you know, and then like, so he's doing this hula hoop. He actually looked pretty comfortable with the hula hoop. He looked like he knew what he was doing with the hula hoop. And then like another hour later, he had these like kind of tassel. They were like flashing like tassels on ropes and stuff. And like, it was just so bizarre. And I'm like, because I was in the restaurant earlier and saw him come in and he didn't have any of that stuff. So I don't know if like there was like a little booth somewhere that you can go get props to dance with. I don't know, but he somehow got them. So he was like probably the number one people watching person. There was also like a guy who, if hip hop was around in the like 60s, I'd imagine he danced like a young Unabomber would have danced if he had listened to hip hop. Like he was just, he kind of looked like the Unabomber, and he had these like very violent movements to his dances. And it was just like, it was kind of scary and like, it was just weird.
Were they dancing next to each other? Was this a contrast thing?
I wish they were, because if they were, I probably wouldn't have watched the show. I probably would have spent the entire time just filming them. And then there was like, those were the two. There was one lady who just, I mean, you know, she just really wanted a piece of that DJ. I mean, it was just her and him in the room, apparently, as far as she was concerned. But yeah, Sebastopol. If you get a chance to get to Sonoma County, Go to Hot Monk Tavern. Watch any show. I'm sure to be
Hot Monk Tavern, by the way. We're giving you the free promo here. Hop Monk Tavern. That's so Sebastopol. You get the hops, you get the monks, you get the tavern. That's great, Cut. And you did this on a Thursday night, so
yeah.
You sound a little spry for having gone out on a Thursday night.
Hanging on by a thread. I have all I have to give is going to be given to this show, and then I probably will fall asleep.
Well, thank you for that. I got roped into watching Beer Fest last night, which is like a 3-beer minimum if you're watching that movie.
Seen that one?
Have you seen it?
No, who's in it?
The Broken Lizard Troop. The guys that did, what is that movie? The Super Troopers. Those guys.
Okay.
You know what, Koz? You should watch this movie because you've been in the acting industry. You know how this all goes. Like, I think they put out a quality stupid movie. Like you can see the joke within the joke. And they didn't have that in Super Troopers 2. It was kind of bad. Some of their other stuff is hit or miss. Those guys are really funny, though. And anyway, it's a 3-beer minimum to watch that movie because it's about a beer drinking competition. Uh-huh. And you can't watch that without drinking just a little faster and a little bit more. So as I was doing projections for the Brewski 150, if there's a section of the projections that was particularly drunk, it was that section. No, actually preparing for projections is what we were doing over there as we get ready for the basketball season, which is basically a 24/7, 365 thing here. So stuff continues to happen. We have, this Steve Ballmer press conference, and I guess we'll call it that because he's like the only guy in the world that can pull this off. You just signed Kawhi Leonard and Paul George, and these are the two of the biggest names in the NBA. And the press conference is all about you. and I don't think they minded, looking at them. I think they were just like, we're here just like you guys are watching this show here. And we don't know quite what to make of it, but he seems harmless, so we'll go with it.
that's the only thing that saves him is he seems harmless. Like the very first things out of his mouth, he's like, "Yeah, I got these notes."
Did he do that? Did he do the classic take the notes and tear them up and throw them over your shoulder?
He didn't throw them, but he was like, "I got these notes, but this is pretty cool." It's like.
That's when the adrenaline kicks in.
Oh, when someone's screaming about something being cool in the most uncool possible way, it's just great. And he started to clap, and that it's such a violent clap. It's so violent.
It is. If you're in the front row, you probably brace yourself. Is this guy going to hit me?
Totally. It's such a weird clap.
We did some reporting on he had a couple meetings when in his Microsoft days where people came out of those meetings not thrilled, with that kind of a deal. And we also did a joke tweet, which will live in fame. It will live in fame.
He's just such a bizarre man. He's just Ballmer.
Yeah, so if you didn't get a chance to see this thing, just YouTube it. Obviously, it's worth your time. It's kind of like the Kawhi Leonard laugh thing. There's always a thing, right? There's a thing every day that you got to see.
Speaking about Kawhi, did you hear what he said? He was like, I don't have any social media, so I couldn't. They were talking about the fans of Toronto. He's like, so I couldn't thank the fans. I couldn't write a paragraph or whatever.
Kawhi is that dude, man. He unlike a lot of people, players, he definitely is not buying into social media as a concept.
No.
But there are people in our lives that they just don't care about what's going on in the social media space, and they live wonderful lives. Yes. I'm not saying you can't be on social media and balance it all, because that's really when you hear people complain about this stuff. Yes, we have to do it for our job, so we're kind of stuck no matter what. But if you can't kind of relate to the social media in the right way, that's kind of on you.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be the end all be all. And it's very hard. I mean, especially in today's day and age with what we see on social media, it's hard. But Kawhi's not that. He literally, and this is actually, you know, NBA teams operate in this space as well. I mean, heck, I was just reading this thing on James Dolan, who obviously doesn't care what anybody thinks. But teams, they literally don't care what is going on social media. They care when terrestrial media or bigger name media get their cues from social media and run with those kinds of things. But Kawhi doesn't care. And you kind of get that in these recent interviews. He had a great one with Chris Haynes of Yahoo, where Chris is great, man. You know, kind of talked with him a little bit at a summer league that we went to. You know, did some Twitter back and forth with him when he was covering the Blazers. He can play ball, actually, too, so that's a random thing. But he really got quite a loosen up and just sort of talk about free agency. And I think the biggest takeaway is Kawhi just was going to do his thing no matter what. And his circle is really small and tight, and they don't leak. You know, maybe a little here and there, but so he comes to this, you know, all of this kind of fanfare and commotion with a really interesting, I don't, you know, give a blank bleep, you know, about any of it. Now, Paul George sitting next to him on the right, I would say, is the exact opposite and does stuff all the time that shows he really cares about social media. Yeah. And stuff like that. So we'll cover a little bit about the Clippers here. We didn't spend that much time on them. I think we either, with them or the Lakers, one or the other, on the last show we did for post-free agency stuff, we said we were going to talk about the Lakers or the Clippers. I think we said we were going to talk about the Clippers in a future show, and then said we were going to talk about the Lakers, and then didn't talk about them because we were going too fast. So we'll spend some time talking about the Clippers here. But yeah, no, I mean, that press conference really, I mean, it did. The Clippers are buzzy right now. They're they got the players. They got really unique personnel defensively. Like,
yes,
and we both love defense. Thankfully,
yeah.
I don't. There are many people and players that only care about offense, and I don't know how they make it through the day.
I know, right?
But
nothing gets my. My biscuits bacon like a good 24-second shot clock violation. That's what I like.
You know, I it's a very unsexy thing, but not really. I mean, the crowd goes wild. I like it. I like it, and they can do this with Pat Beverly. I mean, Shamit can move. Is it pronounced Shamit or is it? I think it's Shamit.
Think about that. Like, you're Shamit. Well, I guess Lou Williams is your worst perimeter defender. But, like, Shamit, if he plays for 10 years, there's not going to be a whole lot of time where he's the fourth best defender on the perimeter on his team. You know, like, that's pretty nuts. Like, not that he's a great defender, but it's pretty good.
I'll say this. I don't really know what his ceiling is. Like, I know it's not elite player, and I know people will make the kind of easy comparison to Klay Thompson.
No. No.
Yeah. But I think he moves a little better than Klay did at that stage of his career.
What do you mean, defensively? Or,
I mean, defensively, laterally, quick, lateral quick. The big thing with him is the lateral quickness. I just was not ready for that. You know, watching him as a rookie, you know, and towards the end of the year, like, I just wasn't ready to see that speed. So I think, you know, he's got a ton of upside there, and he can shoot. So where does he go from there? Like, does he have a chance at being a Klay Thompson? I don't know.
Yeah, I do. He does not. but he's a really good player. I mean, I think that he is a possible... I mean, I think he can make an all-star team, you know, at some point down the road. I think that he's that good, but...
But he's not going for 39 and a quarter.
He might, but I don't know that he can do that, like, to where it's not as big a deal. Like when Clay has some of these, I mean, the 39 was pretty crazy, but like some of the time, some of the things he does when he has these spurts, you're like, it's got a little routine. It's not surprising. You know, you should always be surprised when a guy like doesn't dribble the ball and scores like 20 points in the quarter. Like that should always surprise you. But with Clay, it's like, just went a little Clay on us, you know? But Shamit's a really good
Patrick Beverley, Landry Shamit, Kawhi Leonard, Paul George. That is absurd defensively. And at the same time, they do have these holes. You know, when you add Montrezl Harrell, I think a lot of people look at Harrell and think he is an elite defender. And I don't know that he's that.
Just think he plays really hard.
he does that, and he has these really unique, you know, athletic skill sets. Like he does move pretty well laterally. He's got good jumping ability. He's long for his height. There's something instinctually that's kind of maybe not quite there, and maybe over pursuing certain angles.
I think he might get lost a little bit from time to time, and like. Rotations to the perimeter, the angle stuff. But I think like he does. If a guy, the few guys that do try to work on the block, I think he does a really good job of getting back and getting to his spots and forcing them off. You know, getting there first and not letting them establish position. I think he's got really good hands. You know, he does a good job of getting at the ball before you get it up. I think playing hard, really hard on both ends, and he's going to sprint back on offense every time. So I think playing, people don't understand how much playing hard, how much that covers up, how many faults that'll cover up. Like when you're a big guy and you got to chase, you go down and you try to make a move, you miss, whatever, you're running around setting screens, and then the guy that you're covering is in a full out sprint. Like almost every single possession, that's going to wear you down, and it really covers up for all the other faults that he has. So
I love, you know, we're looking at players as they enter the league, and there was a lot of them that had this sort of like wasn't recruited, you know, they're coming into the league with a chip on their shoulder, and that's Kawhi, you know, even Paul George to a certain degree. True. You know, he went 12, I think, with Indy. You know, wasn't given anything early on. I think this, like, you're just seeing such a clear distinction between high-end players that came into the league through the Duke recruiting machine or whatever, you know, blue blood school. They were preordained, and then they got into the league with a big old reputation, and now they just have these foundational issues that people are like, well, why can't they get to the next level? Well, it's just sitting right there, obvious for you. And you know what? I mean, heck, we're going to talk about Sam Presti here in a second, you know, and that's a franchise that's fallen to that kind of a thing, you know, with their superstars. But, you know, back to the Clippers, they just have done such a great job, obviously, bringing in this talent, but they've got that unique defensive skill set that we just don't see that very often. You know, I think what, maybe Detroit, you know, had a kind of defense where you thought, okay, this could wear you out, you know?
Yeah. It's been a while. I mean, there's been other great teams, but not like, they're going to be really, we've talked about this. It's not like they're chumps on offense either, which is even crazier. Like normally teams that have this kind of, defensive, you know, ceiling, you know, they're going to be like a bunch of guys that are role players and not be able to light you up. I mean, they've got a lot of scoring on this team. There's a lot of pop. So, you know, when you think about playoffs and, you know, playoffs are all about matchups. I have a hard time seeing where teams are going to go offensively, since the league is so much perimeter oriented now. I just don't know what you're gonna do if you've got to go through George and Kawhi. You know, like, that's maybe the best 2-3 combo defensively we've seen since, what, Jordan and Pippen, maybe? I mean, it's been a while.
I mean, yeah, you really got to look at that, you know. That's the pedigree we're talking about here. And I'm really interested to see what Doc Rivers does with it all. Like, will he a lot of teams are getting smart, you know, with all the switching that's going on. They're working the offensive glass off of these switches, you know. Mm-hmm. They're sort of living with, okay, you're going to switch this. We're just going to move the ball around, and now you got to box this guy out. And, you know, some of these, especially a guy like Montrez, isn't the greatest rebounder, but, like, you know, the leapers out there, you know, the John Collinses of the world, you know, that can really just get around, you know, almost like a football player on a defensive end, get around, get under, and just punish a Trae Young, you know, or whoever it is that's out there, you know. Yeah. And so what I'm wondering is, does Doc Rivers have these guys fight through screens because they got so much versatility? And then what are you doing? You know, you're kind of like, you're bringing a defense that nobody else has, and, you know, teams might not react well to that. So it could be, I mean, a lot of dynamic, you know, things that they can bring to the table. I do have a question for you before we move on. You sound like you really want to say something, so I'll just shut up.
Does it surprise you that teams don't have multiple strategies, particularly in the playoffs, when there's so much time to do that kind of thing? Like, you know, you can do the switch everything, but wouldn't it behoove you to, like, throw in these, like, stretches of the game where you are going to fight through everything just to see? Because so many – the offenses have gotten so lazy, especially if you have, like, a big-time score. Like, say you have a Kyrie Irving. It's just a given – to him and to the team that he's going to get the ball. He's going to dribble up top he's going to waste 8-10 seconds. A screen's going to come. He's going to get the switch he wants. Like, if they do all that and you don't switch, you're in a world of hurt if you have those kind of elite defenders on him, you know? And it just surprises me that more teams don't, like, mix it up.
It's with, especially, you have unlimited resources, right? So you could theoretically hire, you know, coaching that could be specific to that kind of coordination on the court. And they are doing it to some degree. But what I think you're talking about is, if you had your way, you know, how would you run this thing? And I would say you probably do some. I mean, it's like, you know, I pitch baseball, so, like, you know, you're constantly trying to set people up. So you go fastball, curve, you know, just keeping people off balance. And that is kind of what you don't see in the NBA, because these guys do, you know, they fly in, you know, let's say it's the second game on the back to back, you know, they're flying in and they're playing the Suns. They ain't thinking about that game. You know, if it's a good team, they should be, but, you know, reality is that they might not be. So you're not bringing your A game into that game. You probably, it's not even wise to show your A game, frankly.
You
should practice that. You should probably give that, you know, sort of a way to be like, this is who we are. We switch our defense pretty frequently throughout the game just to show you guys different looks. And so when the playoffs come around, you can do the whole Rocky thing where you switch from southpaw to regular or vice versa, you know, and they're like, what the hell? I don't know what to do now. And that's not a part of this league right now, which is weird. You would think that, you know, winning would bring that into the equation. The want to win would bring that into the equation. But my question for you is, before we spin over to Presti, is, That press conference was kind of like, it wasn't arrogant, because Steve Ballmer, like, there's no way to categorize him like that.
Yeah.
But to me, it did serve as like a kind of like a, to the rest of the league, hey, you know, we're here, and you got a respected coach in Doc Rivers. You got Lawrence Frank pulling strings in the background. They look pretty damn happy up there, and for good reason. I mean, you're a Laker fan. They're having their problems. They did just bring in Anthony Davis, you know, so they get a bite at the apple here. Who do you think owns LA in 5 years?
in 5 years, I think it's probably going to be the Clippers because they'll have won a couple of rings. Like I don't want to be like. I'm glad that you said that it seemed arrogant because it did. It did. The press felt like they damn well know they're going to win a championship if everyone's healthy. Like, and it wasn't like obnoxiously arrogant, but like they're just like the way the game is being played, like the kind of guys. This isn't just a collection of talent. It's what you were talking about earlier. It's the kind of guys like Patrick Beverley and Montrezl Harrell and Kawhi Leonard are never going to not be playing hard. You know, they're not going to be like, oh man, they just didn't bring it on defense. No, that's just not going to happen. You know, and so it's just, I mean, like think of what Lou Williams is going to be able to do offensively with Kawhi Leonard and Paul George on the floor with them. Like, no, like we haven't even touched on that all our Clippers talk. Like, one of the absolute best one-on-one scorers in the league will never be double teamed on this team, ever. And more importantly, he's gonna have guys running at him pretty much every game.
You know, I had the thought right now of like kind of like when things are going too well, there needs to be like you know, some pushback on that. Like,
right.
So if Kawhi and Paul George are out there doing their thing, you know, and they're getting calls, they're getting star calls. Do the refs kind of look at Lou Williams and go, oh, we can't give you all those calls anymore. Like, this is too much. Like, we've blown the whistle for Kawhi. We've blown the whistle for Paul George now. And then Paul George doesn't draw as many fouls, you know.
He doesn't.
As Kawhi.
He doesn't. But I thought he really turned a corner in that Warriors series. I thought that he found a way to score without getting the calls, and then he ended up getting the calls. Like, he wasn't, like, normally he just kind of, like, in those playoff or intense situations, he doesn't get the calls, and then he just kind of fades away. Like, he kept being ultra aggressive and then he found ways to score, and then eventually he did start to get his calls again. So I don't see that kind of finding that little bit of, you know, the magic potion of confidence in that situation, I can't imagine that goes away now that you have two really good players on your team. You know, like, basketball is one of those sports where, like, when you just get really good players, everybody's more confident. So I can't imagine that's going to happen, really. But,
well, I'll say this. The only question mark I have with them in a championship is what the bigs do. And I'm not even sure if it matters. Like, I'm thinking about like a Joel Embiid taking somebody like Zubac down to the block and just wrecking him. You know, I'm thinking, but even then, would he be quick enough with his moves to beat those double teams from that group of defenders that can recover, that can dig? I mean, it's.
And that's the one, I think, and I don't know that they want to do this. Like the one, I was talking to somebody the other day, and they're like, well, you're talking a lot about the Clippers. What's the path for the Lakers to win? And I was like, well, it's pretty simple. It's LeBron James and Anthony Davis dedicating themselves to the block. I mean, like, the Clippers will not be able to do anything with it.
And both of those guys just want to shoot threes.
And they just want to shoot threes.
That's, I mean, there was a quote from Anthony Davis that said he really was working on his pull-up game. And I kind of just laughed. Like,
can you imagine like having that body and that kind of talent, and that's what you're working on?
You know,
that's like it's like an
issue as old as time, man. I remember bigs always going to the 3-point line. No, man, you can't do that. Now, of course, it's smart to do that now. And, you know, it really is. But, like, oh, man. And everybody tries to blame it on illegal defense rules. And it's like, okay, I get it. Yeah, you have a bit of a problem there with the way that the defense is called. Still, I mean, and credit to Joel Embiid. He does this as well as anybody. I mean, when he wants to, he gets devastating down. we're going to be debuting. I believe that's coming next week, and I believe we have a pretty damn good guest. I don't want to put anybody on. I mean, here's the pressure. It's Brandon Marcus. He does a great job for us in our fantasy stuff, but he's been kind of around the league a little bit and obviously does really good work. So that show's going to be phenomenal, and it's going to be starting next week. So they'll cover that. You guys should just follow Hoopball Clips. That's where that's going to be. And we're excited because that's going to be where the action's going to be. So we've got pods for that. We have pods for the Nets. We have pods for the Lakers. And we might have pods for another team to be named really soon. So we'll see how that goes. All right, let's talk about Charlotte. The Sam Presti. What's that?
Charlotte. Please make it Charlotte.
Oh, man, that's looking rough in Charlotte. I looked at that roster the other day. I'm putting out some win totals here pretty soon. I went, was it 13-9, 12-9 last year? And I'm really disappointed because, like, I felt like I should have gone way better than that. And I typically do. But Charlotte, I was looking at their wins. I think their win total is like 2 this year. Sam Presti. Yes. The great Sam Presti. I'm willing to call him great. I think, you know, if you last in this league like he has, you know, and everybody has the highest respect for him, which I think has worked against him. Like, I don't think he isn't burned the way that a lot of general managers burn. And you learn a lot in the fire. He penned this really long, verbose sort of letter to Oklahoma, to Oklahoma City. Okay. It really was like long. it kind of kept thinking of Jerry Maguire, like, you know, like he had the pizza and then he stayed up late and then he sent this out and then chased it down. Like, oh, I can't believe I sent that. Now, it wasn't that. But there was a line in there about small market teams. I'll find it here somewhere in this article. It was basically small market teams are at a disadvantage. Given the way the league system is designed, small market teams operate with significant disadvantages. There is no reason to pretend otherwise. This is in no way means that we cannot be extraordinarily successful. We and several other small to mid-market teams are our own best examples of the ability to overcome these realities. It's a pretty good humble brag there. It simply means we must be thinking differently, optimistically finding our advantages by other means. I think he's a planner, if, you know, like a...
Yeah.
And I know he's, you know, and I've told folks on this show and other shows that I'm a big meditator. I'm pretty sure he does the same thing. So I think he's on kind of like the edge of like, what's the new, you know, ways of running a franchise. And everybody talks about how well that franchise is run. And I think they do a great job with media. And I think that they, you know, they probably run pretty damn well internally. But this, here comes the big but. The small market thing is kind of an excuse to me. I do think that there are, you know, challenges there. But the way you bring in free agents is these guys want to win titles. You know, the strength of the team, the strength of the decisions that you've made. It's kind of like you're going in for a job. Here's your resume. You know, what I did is I spent $20 million on $15 million each on power forwards, 5 of them. You know, I'm the Knicks. You know, come sign with me. Yeah. Or I draft really well every year. You know, we have a great player development program. You know, we are constantly competitive and we're always finding that diamond in the rough and bringing them in and making the most out of it. So, like, yeah, people like LA, people like Miami, you know, they like New York, I guess.
In theory, New York.
James Dolan deserves his own show, like a reality show about him, or, you know, like a Hard Knocks, the James Dolan version. But like, okay, so I'm looking at this and I'm kind of just like, at what point in time does this Thunder team learn from that mistake that they made way back when, which is turning the franchise over to Kevin Durant? and Russell Westbrook and Kendrick Perkins, to be frank, and Scott Brooks. Like, it was like they all sort of bought their own, what they were preaching. They bought it hook, line, and sinker, and they couldn't stop themselves from jacking up bad shots, letting Kevin Durant dictate the way that that offense worked, you know, and obviously Russell Westbrook letting, you know, him dictate how he was going to play. And then the fact that they had to have Kendrick Perkins on the floor during all those winnable playoff games, that it was just so obvious that he was getting beat every single time down the floor, that he had to be on the floor because those guys wanted him on the floor. Scott Brooks wanted him on the floor. Well, that to me is the legacy of this team. Like, they had it in their hands. They should have won like 3 championships.
Right.
But they didn't. So what was your thoughts when you heard Presti's, you know, or heard about Presti's letter to the public?
I hadn't heard much of the letter, but that part that you read was pretty funny. I heard a lot of his, I was listening to his press conference, and, you know, like, I don't know. I mean, he's never going to come out and say, hey, I screwed up. I should have had a harder-nosed coach in there. Because I believe when he was drafted, Durant, and they were still in Seattle, I believe his first coach was PJ Carlissimo.
That's correct.
And so, like, that is definitely the opposite of Scott Brooks. So I think maybe...
But that was a weird year for those guys. I mean, Presti worked underneath, you know, the whole Robert, or why am I forgetting his first name? Schultz. The CEO of Starbucks that was running for president.
Yeah, okay.
Robert Schultz? I don't know why. I had 3 too many beers last night. that organization was under just weird ass conditions. Like, they were all being told a lie, you know, to the public about the move. You had Clay Bennett, you know, installed at that point in time as well. He was moving the team no matter what, you know. Right. So it was a weird, and they gave Kevin Durant the ball and just said, shoot. I mean, he was averaging like, I want to say 22, 23 shots as a rookie. That is a lot of shots for a rookie.
Yeah.
And he was playing shooting guard.
Yeah.
Too. So some weird stuff there, but go on.
But no, I think maybe, you know, and I'm not as hard on Scott Brooks, I think, as you. Like, the skill set of people liking you is valuable for an NBA. It doesn't get you tight playoff wins.
But that's my Yeah.
It is valuable. Now, I don't know Maurice Cheeks was there, but he's also cut from the cloth of players really liking him also. So at some point you have to decide that the best possible thing is going to be for these guys to be good, sound basketball players. Decision making wise as well. And I think that the lack of confidence in themselves as an organization, because they come off like, well, we're one of the premier small market, you know, teams, but they operated in this like, we're so afraid of losing these guys that we're not really gonna run the organization the way we know it should be run.
You're nailing this, man. You're absolutely nailing this.
So afraid we're going to lose these guys, and they've now lost everybody.
And they left. Well, and this is. I mean, we're going to talk about free agency and tampering here in a second. This is the ball game. Like, the, you know, Kendrick Perkins. It's funny. He tweeted some stuff about Mark Jackson saying he was getting blackballed for his religious beliefs, and I'm not buying that for 1 second. And Perk has said
He is being blackballed. I'll give him that. But
is he? I feel like he gets mentioned for jobs. I mean, he got mentioned in Sacramento. You know, like there was a legitimate balloons being floated up you know, inside the walls within the Kings about Mark Jackson. I feel like were they real? Yeah, no, I think there's a lot of players around the league that like Mark Jackson, and if the players like him, I think he will get another chance if he wants to get out of the booth. And there's an issue, you know, if you're in the booth for too long, you kind of lose your fastball. So we'll see if he can, you know, get back into the game that way. But no, Kendrick Perkins, like, he's been out there saying all sorts of stupid stuff. He's been on Fox a lot, so I guess that's kind of their deal. you know, the shouting shows. I know, right? Rim shot, ba-boom. But he's been saying all this stuff, and I'm like, I'm wondering when the media is going to figure out what happened with the Thunder. Because as it was happening, so you said, you know, I'm not as down on Scott Brooks as you are. And like, I think you nailed the whole story with Brooks. He was good at making friends with the players or getting out of their way and doing what they wanted him to do while preaching kind of the kind of coach by narrative stuff that you'll see around the league, which is, you know, some of it's really smart, some of it's really good, but some of it's kind of like, it'd be great if you could show me something useful to do versus just telling me to play harder.
right.
You know, I'm playing hard, Scott. I can't play any harder than this. Interestingly, I thought Brooks did a lot of, you know, talking about how those guys didn't play hard at times, and it was really funny. You're like, okay, you're playing Kendrick Perkins, he's getting beat every play. How is it these guys' fault that they're not playing hard when you have a coaching issue, strategy issue, that's the linchpin of the defense falling apart? But you know, the media never understood or even like wanted to even broach this topic that Scott Brooks was messing up there. I mean, it happened eventually in the Heat series, but the Kendrick Perkins stuff had been happening for a couple years, and it never got noticed or mentioned. So it was kind of like we're all talking on Twitter about why this game is the way that it is, and there's this glaring thing. And I think, you know, high-end media, they really like Presti, so they don't want to dig in on him, and they don't want to dig in on Brooks because they all like Brooks too. He's really good with media, you know. So nobody talked about this stuff until the Heat series when Chris Bosh was just destroying him. And by then, it sort of kind of came into focus. But if you're competing for a championship, which is what they were doing, you have to have that coach that can get you over the hump. And that's where you get this Steve Kerr narrative that took place in Sacramento when they're kind of like, we got to get rid of Dave Yeager. You know, so we're going to bring in Luke Walton because he's the guy that can get us over the hump. You know, you hear this all over the place. But I think with Kendrick out there talking, I'm wondering, like, are you guys all going to figure out that this temperament for this team, he might have been the center of it. And the center of it being like, we just need to play harder. You know, not like, here's a strategy thing. Kevin, don't get the ball at 35 feet and, you know, let the guy get up into you and you get stripped because you can't play with, you know, ball pressure. Or Russ, don't jack that shot. That's not a good one.
Right. I mean, I think it's a lot. I think that, you know, I think it's a lot of, I think you might be letting Presti off the hook a little bit too much. I mean, like, they definitely, I think the way that they, not only did they, were they soft with Brooks and coaching them, and then forget about the game situations. I'm just talking about, like, from the beginning of training camp and what you're going to demand of players. But they also, on the other end, which I think fed into what we were talking about earlier, with guys, you know, guys that have always had, you know, the high recruits and all that stuff, they run the media there like it's you know, Alabama football, to where if you question one of their guys, you know, if you know it's like you ask Nick Saban a tough question, you better be ready to be covering a intramural volleyball for Alabama.
It's a weird dynamic there, because I think the national guys with some weight, they feel that pressure. Like,
yeah. Well, because you got this team, you think about it, you got this team of these, you got the three of the most electric young players in the league, and, you know, they're all the rage. you're going to want to get an interview with them. You know, like, it's just it's just the way it is. Like, you don't want to go like, oh, you know, they're really doing some, I know that this team is really, really, really good, but, you know, I tell you what, those moves they're making in Milwaukee, even though they're not that good, I tell you what, those guys know how to run an organization. I'm going to talk to some of them. I'm going to go talk to Brandon Jennings. No. You want to be in with the hot team, with the hot story. So I think there was the overall guide for the way they ran the entire organization was, we can't lose these guys. So we'll make it as easy as possible on the floor, in practice, bring in who they want. Don't, you know, say what, only get fluff questions in the media. And life don't work that way. You gotta get some skin.
I think
in
this
game.
Is actually a league problem. Like there's the Knicks are getting heat right now for the way they conduct their media. You know, and what I think the league needs to do is just step in and basically say, like, teams, you kind of lose control here. You lose, like, you can't be restricting access if you're a for-profit. Like, there's a lot of, you know, question, like, you know, should somebody be credentialed, you know, like, you know, they're doing a blog and they basically don't, you know, they don't, it's not really a thing. You know, should they be getting credentials to get into whatever? And then you just have everybody else, you know, that's, you know, running whatever for-profit enterprise. And, you know, the league should step in and say, basically, teams, you got to let them have, you know, time with the players. You got to let them have this, that, and the other, and just stick with, there's rules actually already on the book about a lot of this stuff. But, you know, like the Thunder, they definitely do, they go to the one end of the scale where they're not going to let you talk to the players, you know. Mm-hmm. and that puts, you know, culturally, if you can't go, and this is what Steve Kerr does really well, he's so loose and easy with the media. And the Warriors, Raymond Ritter is the pro's pro. Like, he's going to figure out, you know, like, if you're a legitimate enterprise, you know, and you do the work, you're going to come in and you can talk with Steve Kerr openly and honestly. And the same thing with a lot of their players. You know, they make them available. And it's just run like a well-oiled machine. And right. if you're an organization that can't be criticized,
right,
what does that do internally to your people? I mean, how can you tell Russell Westbrook not to take an 18-footer he shouldn't take if he can't sit with the local beat writer and just chop it up? You know, it really speaks a lot of the player empowerment era, which is this free agency issue that Steve Kerr was talking about when he said Anthony Davis's trade wasn't good for the league. And he said that on Monty Poole's great Warriors Insider podcast, I might add. There's people out there not giving him his credit for his interview. Imani's one of the good guys. But, you know, like, if you can't be criticized, it's going to filter through to the Russell Westbrooks, the Kevin Durants, and they might not look in the mirror, right, you know, with this kind of stuff. And free agency has sort of created this kind of question for the league. Is this stuff good for the league? And I would argue that if you're forcing your way out of New Orleans the way that you did, if you're Anthony Davis, that would be an example of something that's not necessarily great for the league. And at the same time, players should have just as much freedom to make decisions as teams have. I think.
I think that it's, you know, it's one of those things where, like, to me, like, these, you know, the tampering stuff and all that, you gotta be comfortable in your own skin. Like, you gotta say, you know, like, the Paul George thing is funny, because Kendrick brought that up when he was on NBA radio. He brought that up, how that's not getting looked at the same. And I guess they could both be looked at the same, Anthony Davis and him. But the reality of the situation is, like, if you're a small market team, you do have to have a little bit of the, you know, you got to be excited about being here. You know, like, we're not LA, we're not New York, we're not, you know, Miami, we're not Chicago. Like, you actually have to be excited about being here. And if you're not, I mean, I don't know what else to do to prove to you that this is a good place. You know, we got a good coach. We've drafted well. The fans are nuts. You know, like, you have overwhelming, like, you have, at some point gotta say, like, we're gonna run this thing right. And if you don't want to be here because you got an agent chirping at you and telling you how bad this it is and how everything's gonna be better in one of these other cities, you can't start. You can't shift the organization, because at the end of the day, like, everybody, if every all-star is not gonna win a championship. You know, so they're like there's no guarantee that Anthony Davis is going to get anything in LA. We don't even know if they're going to get to the finals. So why are you going to break your neck to keep a guy that blames you for everything? I mean, Anthony Davis played like crap in that second round series against the Warriors. He played like crap. You know, Kevin Durant in game 6 and 7 against the Warriors played like crap. You know, like, that, at some point, you got to get guys who are going to get in front of the microphone and be like, dude, I played like crap. I was terrible. I got to do better. The Warriors are better than me. This team was better than me. And instead, they're like, oh, you know, if we got to make moves. If we only had this, if we only had that. So I just think some of these small market teams, instead of bitching and moaning about the tampering, They gotta get better guys, and they gotta get guys with character who wanna be there. And not chase them out and call, not like the Spurs and chase Hall of Famers out the door calling them liars. You know, like some of this stuff is easy. Like, you're a Spurs, you're a small market team, you have a legacy already. You screwed this damn thing up. Now you can't blame big city, you can't blame anything. If they hadn't called Kawhi Leonard a liar, he'd be on the Spurs right now, you know. So, like, there's a lot of blame to go around. But the main thing, and I think maybe Utah's the only one that actually stays in their lane like that. I just think that Utah's not a place that a lot of NBA guys want to live in. But they're the one of the small market organizations that I think really stays the course. And says, we're going to get good coaches. They're going to coach guys hard. They're going to do this. And if Gordon Hayward, you want to leave, bye. Here's the max deal. We want you to stay. You don't want to be here. Bye.
Well, that's it.
You know, we're not going to start like saying that no one in the media can say that Gordon Hayward didn't play well. No, he didn't play well. Kick rocks.
That was a blessing in disguise. That had nothing to do with the injury that they didn't keep him.
Absolutely.
You know, he was overpriced. But
Absolutely. But
there's two things that you've circled around here, and we've only got a little bit of time, but I do want to touch on them. So one is this sort of like, it's the operation the players are running, I think, is extremely sophisticated now, as everything has gotten more sophisticated. So I think with data and news traveling so fast, like, guys can, like, I mean, the reorganization of interests, you know, interests throughout the league, my interests as a player, my interests as an agent, like, these things can expand and collapse at rates that we've never seen before. So, like, the league can pivot on one player's decision. And I think maybe 5 to 10 years ago, that stuff might not have happened, you know, like, so guys are finding their lane that's good for them. And they're basically saying, look, I don't want to be here anymore. So you can either deal with that. You know, we'll go through this together. It'll be bumpy and you might not like that, but here's where I really want to be. And I'm not going to re-sign with you. You know, they play their leverage. And so throughout the league, there's now this culture of like, who am I playing with? Who are we getting? You know, yeah. And they're like kind of just like looking around the league. And if the grass is greener on the other side, then they start getting, you know, itchy, you know, they just get an itch and they're like, I got to go. And this, you know, has been translated into by agents, I think, are selling these players pretty damn effectively. You know, like, it's about player empowerment and all this BS. It's like, it's not about, I mean, you watch Anthony Davis on that show that LeBron has on HBO. He looked like he had been brainwashed by a cult.
Yeah.
and said that, he didn't even sound remotely confident in what he said.
Yeah.
And it's like this pretext for why I went to L.A. No, no, it's not that. You just wanted to be in L.A.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
But then it comes back to how do you conduct yourself to get it?
Even that, like, you know, if you take away, like, okay, you didn't know, like, not knowing, like, Zion is the only reason, only thing that I think changed things. Like, getting the number one pick. If Anthony Davis was inclined to think about Stan, then, like, you're like, okay, we're going to match him up with Zion. But they did get a haul for him. You know,
because the, like, Lakers were stupid.
Let's go with OKC.
I was saying that a little facetiously, but
no, they are stupid. But, like, let's just say, like, you know, if Paul George was like, I love OKC, he starts looking at different businesses to invest in there. He's buying a little vacation spot by a lake, whatever. And OKC is like, he's on board with OKC. If the Clippers call him and call OKC and offer what they offered, even though Paul George wanted to be there, they got to make that trade. The Paul George Russell Westbrook combination has got you out in the second round and now out in the first round, like, not even close in the first round. So it's this whole, like, player empowerment, like it's like we always talk about LeBron, like, as far as being GMs go, they don't know what the hell they're doing. So if you're an organization, like, just be you and be an organization and let that, all this stuff, because
that's,
people are gonna, they're gonna learn, like Russell Westbrook is gonna be like, dude, man, like, I mean, I like shooting the ball 30 times in the fourth quarter, but it'd be nice if James Harden, like, kind of showed up and acted like he wanted to play. You know, like, you're gonna find that out.
I want to bring it home on this point you're making, because, like, what you're seeing is the players are trying to move around and improve their own personal situations, and agents are really pushing buttons, and the ability to push your way out of contracts is really what I think people are sort of kind of not good with. Like,
yes.
It's, yes. Like, I think, at least if, you know, when you're talking with people that aren't mouth breathing, you know, idiots, they can go, they can do the two and two here. They can go, the team has no problem cutting or trading or whatever scenario we're talking about. Yeah. You know, they might not play you, right? You know, like, there's things the teams do all the time. And yes, players should be able to do all of that stuff. And it just depends on the context. You know, like, yeah. What is it that's being done? Like, Carmelo Anthony, the way he pushed his way out of Denver was not great. That team was in turmoil the entire time it was going on. And thankfully for the Nuggets, the Dolan got involved and was like, I got to trade half the team, even though he wants to come here in free agency anyway, you know, yeah. You know, so it all worked out for Denver in the long run. But at the time, it wasn't a very good pushing out of a place, you know, and, you know, there's other examples all over the place, but so players are doing that, and GMs like Sam Presti are, you know, they want to be player friendly all over the place. Like, they that's the whole thing right now, is like, how are you relating to your players? How are you marketing them? How are you pumping them up about your organization? Because they feel, teams, that is, they feel that players have all the cards. Like, they can basically do whatever they want. So this backs into a really kind of interesting thing about just people in general, is like, how do you comport yourself? Do you morph to be like them, or do you morph to be like what somebody else might want you to be? Or do you subscribe to your own philosophy, make it good, and then say, this is what we do here.
Right.
This isn't what we do for you. I mean, we do lots of things for you, but this is what we do here. And if you don't like that, then you can, you know, go kick rocks. Yeah. So you stay true to yourself that way. And that's with Presti, you know, like that. I wonder, you know, they got all these picks. They should be able to, and he should have the ability to, you know, really make a contender. But this letter felt like he was asking for like a 10-year pass.
Right.
You know?
Right. And the thing too about this, you know, just to like, because we got to run, but like that what you just said and what I've been saying is like, the only thing that's different, it's not just like, you know, what we, you know, how we comport ourselves as people. There's decades of history to back up you doing the right thing in most sports. Like, we know an organization runs best when the owner hires smart people and writes checks. The GMs are very good at drafting and get key, don't shoot for defenses on free agents, but get key free agents and developing players well. Like, that's in across the board in every sport forever. That's how success has been maintained. So, like, you saying, like, this is what we're going to do here, regardless of what you think or what you want, if you're doing those things, it's actually backed up by decades of success in every sport. So it's not like you're, it's not even a new philosophy. It's like, dude, this is what we're going to do here. Like, that's what the Warriors did. Like, you throw all that other BS out the thing. That's all they did was draft well, develop.
And the people that get that, the people who understand this, the winners out there, you know, the Kawhi Leonards, you know, the winners, they will see that from miles away. It'll be like a beacon in the sky, and they will just attract to your organization. And, you know, this all funnels back into, you know, if you're the Knicks and you run a paranoid organization that doesn't bring the media in, that's going to have an impact. If you're trying to make good with superstars by just doing whatever they say, that's going to have an impact. You know, and it's all this leadership starts from the top thing. And as it relates to free agency and tampering, for whatever that's, I can't even do the tampering conversation. I know there's investigations and there's things with inducements. All that stuff probably does need to be continually cleaned up. But at the end of the day, this is business. This is, you know, players talking on the blacktop, so to speak. You know, I want to play with you, you want to play with me. That stuff's going to keep happening. Tampering is sort of just a symptom, you know, of whatever the system is. And if you're an organization out there, if you choose that road, that path of staying true to yourself and doing that, you don't have to pitch a free agent on what they want. You can pitch a free agent on what you need, and then filter through the ones that don't understand that, get the guys, like you said, the key free agents. And really, honestly, like, every free agent out there has a value. Like, if you can go and say, look, I got this guy, I got him at a good price, I got this guy at a good price, I got this guy at a good price. Now, should they make more? Would I like them to make more money? Sure. But when they don't get that money, that means I can spend it somewhere else. So I'm doing a good job of GMing. They might like more money, and you know, we're kind of at odds with that, but let's be real about it. I'm doing good here, and I'm going to get the next Rashawn Holmes, you know, for $5 million. I'm going to get, you know, I'm not going to spend on Chris Paul $40 million a year. You know, when you have that resume that you can pitch, you know, maybe it works against you a little bit, and that players are like, man, I want you to overpay me. You know, pay me, you know, that whole thing. Like, it might work against you that way, but I think deep down inside, they're going to be like, hey, you know what? We're going to have a lot of salary cap to go get some guys, so I kind of want to be with that guy. Anyway, I love this show, man. This has been fun. I love it. So, I know. Somebody pay us. We got a lot of stuff going on. In fact, we probably should have shouted out Hawaiian Isles at the beginning of the show. I'm getting coffee for us.
No shots.
I'm getting coffee for us. So that's in the works. We got other stuff in the pod side. You guys, can't wait. So stay tuned. We'll be doing some team preview stuff in the coming months. The frequency on that is a little bit up in the air, but we'll keep you guys informed. Follow us online on Twitter at twitter.com/KOZANDBRUshow, where we have not tweeted for, I want to say, 800 days. I feel great about that. And facebook.com/KOZANDBRUshow, where we are great there as well. Koz, great show, man. We'll talk soon. Another one's in the books. Peace.
Peace.